Everybody, and welcome to my second talk for the fourth Geometric Analysis Festival. Recall that my first talk, I was giving an introduction to the level set technique and providing a simple and elementary proof of the non-existence of PC metrics on a torus. And today we're going to have now a look at a non-compact setting, focusing in particular on the space-time positive mass theorem. To get started, let's first have a look at a couple definitions. So one of the objects we're going to study are so-called asymptotically flat manifolds. These are non-compact manifolds where the metric is approaching the Euclidean metric at infinity at a certain rate. Physically, these asymptotically flat manifolds model isolated gravitational systems, such as stars, black holes, or even entire galaxies. And then to each of these asymptotically flat manifolds, there's a geometric quantity you can associate to them, namely the ADM mass. This is given by the decay of the metric at infinity and physically corresponds to the actual mass of the gravitational system. Then we have the positive mass theorem, which tells us that if you have a non-negative energy density, which would correspond to a negative scalar curvature, then you also have non-negative mass. Moreover, we have equality if and only if our manifold is flat Euclidean space. And of this positive mass theorem, there are several proofs available. There's one by minimal surfaces, one by spinners, and then there's also one by inverse mean curvature flower and one by Ricci flower. Moreover, there's been a very recent proof by Bray, Cazares, Curry, and Stern, where they showed not just that the mass is non-negative, but it satisfies the following lower bound. Namely, the mass is bounded from below by 1 over 16 pi times the integral of the Hessian of u squared divided by norm gradient u, plus the scalar curvature times norm gradient u. And note that the right-hand side is always non-negative, so in particular, you have the positive mass theorem. And hereby, u is a harmonic function, so Laplace u is equal to 0, and u is asymptotic to x at infinity. However, the choice of being asymptotic to x is arbitrary, so you could, for instance, also be asymptotic to y or z. So rather than just having here a single lower bound for the mass, you have a whole family of lower bounds for the mass. And moreover, they also obtain a quasi of equality. So in case you have no negative scalar curvature, then the mass is equal to 0 if and only if the manifold is flat. Also, one thing I want to highlight is that this formula is true without assuming no negative scalar curvature, which makes it very different from, say, the spin-off formula for mass. So for spinners, you have a very similar looking formula. However, to get existence of these spinners, you crucially need to assume no negative scalar curvature. All right, let's proceed into the space-time setting. Again, we are starting with a couple of definitions. So the object we are starting now is a so-called initial data set, which is a triple MGK, where MG is an asymptotically flat manifold as before, and K is now a symmetric two tensor. And then to this G and K, we can associate the so-called energy and momentum densities, which are just given by these quantities involving G and K. And then we say that MGK satisfies the dominant energy condition if mu is greater or equal than norm J. And note that mu and J is mostly just depending on K and not on G. So in the case if K is equal to 0, then the dominant energy condition just reduces to non-negative scalar curvature. So you can think of manifolds satisfying the dominant energy condition being a generalization of manifolds of non-negative scalar curvature. And one example, for instance, is when you have a space-like slice in Minkowski space with second fundamental form K, then this would be an initial data set with 0 mu and 0 J. So basically, the K always corresponds to the second fundamental form of the initial data set being embedded in a four-dimensional Lorentzian space-time. Again, we can then also associate certain quantities to the initial data set infinity. So we have the ADM energy and the ADM momentum, which again depends on how G and K behave at infinity. And they form the ADM energy momentum four vector whose length is called the ADM mass. And then there's the positive mass theorem, which tells us that if the dominant energy condition mu greater equal norm J is satisfied, then we also have E greater or equal than norm P, which means non-negative mass. Moreover, we have equality if and only if MGK embeds into Minkowski spacetime, which is actually like a really interesting case of equality because you're not just characterizing one space like Euclidean space before, But you characterize infinitely many spaces because you have infinitely many options to embed into a Minkowski space. All right, let me talk a little bit about the proofs. So the first proof is by the Jang equation, which is something like a prescribed mean curvature equation to reduce the space-time positive mass theorem to the Riemannian positive mass theorem, which has been done by Shen and Yao and then in higher dimensions by Eichmeier. Then there's also a spinner proof using the Lichtenherowitz formula due to Witten. There's another proof using so-called marginally autotrapped surfaces, or short MODs, which combines the stability formula of MODs with the Gauss equations and Gauss-Bonnet theorem. So basically, you can think of MODs as being the space-time analog of minimal surfaces. And in fact, if k is equal to zero, a MODs is nothing else than minimal surface. Then the rigidity case has been then addressed independently by Bay-Krushtal and Tuang Li, and there's also a forthcoming paper joined with Cazares, Curry, and Jang. Moreover, to prove the positive mass theorem, you can also use Lava sets, which is from a joint work with Dimitri Cazares and Marcus Curry from last year. So we've shown that if you have an initial data set, then the energy plus the momentum in x direction are bounded from below by 1 over 16 pi times the integral of Hessian bar u squared divided by norm gradient u plus 2 mu times norm gradient u plus 2 j times gradient of u. And here, Hessian bar u is the Hessian of u plus k times norm gradient u, and u is not a harmonic function but satisfies the following PDE. And again, we have u going to x at infinity. And again, this x is of course arbitrary, for instance, it could also be asymptotic to y at infinity, but then you would get here the momentum in y direction instead. And then note that the right-hand side is of course non-negative if the dominant energy condition holds. So then if you let u be asymptotic to minus the momentum vector at infinity, then you get e greater equal than norm p as desired. So in particular, you get the space-time positive mass theorem. All right, let's talk a little bit about the PDE u satisfies. And this PDE we call the space-time Laplace equation, and we call it u space-time harmonic. Similar, we call Hessian bar u the space-time Hessian. And both of these names are actually very well motivated, both geometrically and physically. And this is what we're going to analyze next. So the question we were asking ourselves is, what is the most natural equation on an initial data set MGK? To do so, we were first taking a step back and assuming that MGK was embedded into a four-dimensional space-time, M bar G bar, and then asking the question, what is the natural equation in the space-time? And one natural equation is always the Laplace equation, of course. So what we could try is to take this very natural equation on M bar and then restrict this equation onto M. And we obtain then the following. We get that zero is equal to Laplace u minus trace k times the normal derivative of u, where the normal is the space-time normal. So if the Laplacian is a natural equation on M bar G bar, then this should also be a natural equation on an initial data set. However, there's a problem because N of u does not make sense from an initial data perspective because you need the whole space-time to make sense of the space-time normal. And so we are running into a problem here. But fortunately, we can resolve this problem by having a closer look at the case of equality. So the case of equality is Minkowski space-time. And Minkowski space-time, the harmonic functions are just given by linear combinations of these coordinate functions. And then it turns out that the normal derivative of u is given by minus the square root of a plus norm gradient u squared, where a is depending on these coefficients z0, z1, z2, and z3. And this formula for the normal derivative holds true for any initial data set MGK. So no matter what slice in Minkowski space you pick, the normal derivative always satisfies this formula. And now the right-hand side of this formula is now completely independent of the space-time, but just depends on the initial data. So that's what we're going to use as our definition. So we call a function u on MGK a general spacetime harmonic function, which for instance would correspond to u equal x or u equal to t in Minkowski space. If Laplacian of u is equal to minus the square root of a plus gradient u squared times trace k. And we call u a null space time harmonic function, just space time harmonic, but if a is, can be chosen to be zero, and that would be, for instance, u equal to x plus t. And these null or just space time harmonic functions are the one we're going to use to prove the space time positive mass theorem. All right, so that's the motivation. And let me make a few additional observations. So given that the normal derivative is equal to minus the norm of the gradient of u, the Hessian of u, or the Hessian ball of u, which we call the spacetime Hessian, is given by this expression over here. And now note that this means it's actually the spacetime Hessian. So if you're like embedded into the spacetime with the normal derivative satisfying this property, then what we call the spacetime Hessian is in fact the actual spacetime Hessian. So that's where the name is coming from. And then there are also some very interesting relationships to the Jang equation. So it turns out that for a equal to one, the spacetime harmonic function is actually just this, a solution to a generalized Jang equation. So you see there's like a very close relationship to the Jang equation on the one hand side. And we see that there's also actually a very close relationship to harmonic spinners. So basically you can think of space and harmonic functions of being in between a Jang equation and spinners. So for spinners, just recall Witten's formula. So Witten proved that E minus norm P is equal to this following integral involving the spinner phi. And then to each spinner, you can always associate a vector field V in the following sense. Namely, we prescribe that for any vector x, the following is true. So basically, V would be like the square of the spinner. And if you then additionally assume that this vector field V, which we always obtain, is integrable, meaning that there's a function U such that the gradient U is equal to V, then it turns actually out that U is spacetime harmonic. So a spinner gives always rise to a vector field, and if this vector field is integrable, this function is spacetime harmonic. All right, let's move on to the proof of the spacetime PMT. So just recall, what we want to show is the following formula. We want to show that E plus the momentum in X direction is bound from below by the following integral involving the spacetime harmonic function U. And to do so, we proceed in four steps. The first step is to solve the spacetime Laplace equation. So now that this is a nonlinear equation because of this norm gradient U term on the right-hand side. And then once we have the existence of this function, we can actually go to the computation and prove this mass formula or the formula for energy and momentum, which is sort of like the heart of the argument. But then it turns out to do so, we actually need to control the topology of the level sets of U, which is gonna be our third point in the proof. And then finally, we also need to prove the case of equality, but I will postpone this to the next lecture. All right, let's talk about existence. So the first step is to solve the linear equation, so Laplace V equal to minus trace K. And note that's basically the space-time Laplace equation, just there is not a norm V on the right-hand side. However, norm V is asymptotic to one at infinity. So it turns out that this is actually a very good approximation of a space-time harmonic function. And because of this, we are then using this function V as directly boundary data and when solving the space-time Laplace equation on compact domains. So basically taking domains, exhausting our manifold and solving on each of them the spacetime Laplace equation. And then we are taking a limit and show that the limit is then our spacetime harmonic function. And then to get the solution on compact domains is then not too difficult. We can just use some standard PDE methods and then extracting the limit just follows by constructing appropriate areas. All right, so let's go to our integral formula. So let's begin by recalling by the formula I had on my very first slide in my first talk, namely that the boundary integral involving the mean curvature is equal to the integral involving the Hessian of U, the scalar curvature of M, the Gaussian curvature of the level sets, and the Laplacian of U. And this formula is basically just following from Bochner's identity and the Gauss equations in the very same spirit as the formula we had in my previous talk when proving the non-existence of PC matrix on a torus. And because it's so similar, I'm going to omit the computation now. And then if you now insert the space-time Laplace equation into this formula up here and integrate by parts, we obtain the following formula. So we get these boundary terms on the left-hand side is equal to the spark integral on the right-hand side. And now if you compare this right-hand side integral with what we want to show, you see it exactly the same. So the only thing which remains to be shown is that the right-hand side integral is converging to 16 pi times the energy plus the momentum in x direction. And then it turns out that this is in fact the case by Gauss-Bernays theorem applied to these level sets over here in case the level sets are non-spherical. So all we have to do now is to show that this level set is non-spherical, and to do so we're going to use the maximum principle. So now that the maximum principle is telling us that there are no spherical level sets if they bound a region. And so basically the maximum principle is then almost enough to give us sufficient control on the level set topology. However, there are still some bad things which can happen. For instance, let's have here a look at the following manifold. So suppose you have your asymptotic manifold like this, and then you have this tube attached to it. And then you could have here like a level set here, sigma t, which is spherical. And in this case, the maximum principle cannot prevent it from being spherical because sigma t is not bounding a region. So basically the problem now is like not the topology of the level sets, but the topology of the manifold itself. So what we now have to do is to rule out these tubes, etc., which would allow for these spherical level sets. All right, so just to conclude, we now just have to simplify the topology of the ambient manifold. This then allows us to control the level set topology in view of the maximum principle, which allows us to use Gauss-Bernays theorem to get our integral formula. All right, so let's do this. So first have a look at the Riemannian setting. That's actually relatively easy because we can just go to the exterior region, which is the region you obtain by removing everything inside the outermost minimal surface of your manifold. However, there's not an analogous statement of this result in the space-time setting. So instead, we're just going to do a more by hand construction, namely iteratively reducing the first Betti number. And to do so, we are taking our manifold with those handles, et cetera, and passing to double sheeted covers. And in this double sheeted cover, we are going to look at the outermost mods and then removing everything in this double cover, which is lying behind this mods or marginary outer trapped surface. And then we obtain the following picture. So we have now a manifold. And because we've iteratively reduced the first Betti number, you're going to have trivial second homology, which is sufficient for the maximum principle application. However, as you see now, the new manifold has no boundary components, which are all either mods or mids. So what remains now is to make sure that these boundary components don't cause any difficulties. In the remaining case, there are actually many ways how to deal with boundaries. So first of all, you could prescribe both Dirichlet and Neumann conditions for your manifold. And then second, you could also just fill in the manifold. So whenever you have a manifold with minimal boundary, you can construct a fill-in which still has non-negative scalar curvature. However, in the space-time setting, there's no such a fill-in method available. and Neumann conditions turn out to also not work. Dirichlet conditions work, but basically just. It turns out there's precisely one constant, which we can use as Dirichlet boundary data, which allow us to make everything work. And basically what we want to create with this constant is the following picture. So if the shaded region is our boundary of our manifold, then we want the level set of the same constant which goes to infinity to nicely touch this region as drawn in this figure over here. And then once we have done this control and level sets, we then get, like mentioned before, get our integral formula, and that proves then the space-time positive mass theorem. All right, let's talk about some further results. So first of all, we also have a positive mass theorem with Kornos, which is a joint work with Peng Zimiao and Tinya Tsang. And again, one uses harmonic functions, and it's very similar as Ray-Cazares Curry-Stern's proof of the Riemannian PMT. You just require some additional regularity for harmonic functions across this Kornos surface. Then you can also prove a PMT with charge, but you know, use a different equation, namely the charge Laplace equation. And this way you can actually characterize the t equals zero slice optimal geometer Papapetri spacetime. Then you can also prove a hyperbolic PMT, where you use again the spacetime Laplace equation. However, this equation is now significantly different in its behavior compared to the asymptotically flat case. The reason is that now K is asymptotic to G rather than being asymptotic to zero. So trace K is not going to zero, but it's going to free at infinity. And that makes the nonlinearity of the equation significantly worse. For instance, where norm gradient U was going nicely to one in the flat case, it goes to zero or infinity, depending on which direction you're looking at in the hyperbolic setting. And then what we were able to do as well was to obtain the equal to norm P rigidity conjecture. So if E is equal to norm P, we are able to show that we are embedding into Minkowski spacetime being asymptotic to the hyperbolic space. And I'm going to talk about this in more detail in the next lecture. So I hope you all enjoyed the talk, and I'm looking forward to see you all in the next one. Thanks.